love on display. And so, you know, God is seated on the throne in heaven. But even though God is seated on the throne in heaven, we don't know how far heaven is from earth. We really don't know. It could be closer than you can imagine, or it could be farther than you could imagine. But one thing we do know is that God sits on the throne in heaven.
Yeah.
But one thing about God sitting on the throne in heaven, he displays his love on earth in and through you and me. And God's greatest display of love was through his son, Christ Jesus.
Amen.
I said God's greatest display of love was through his son, Christ Jesus. We see how God loved his people in the Old Testament, but that was not God's greatest display of love. He loved the children of Israel. He brought them out of Egyptian bondage. He saved them from captivity. But still, that was not God's greatest love of display. As far as his display being seen, how God really truly loved. But Jesus came down through 42 generations, wrapped himself up in swaddling clothes, born of a virgin Mary, tabernacle on earth for 33 and a half years. And then throughout those 33 and a half years, he put God's love on display in a perfect way. He displayed the love of God to perfection in order to set the bar real high and for you and me to live. Y'all get that?
Yes.
And so then, you know, Jesus, he tabernacled on earth for 33 and a half years. It was God's will for his son to display love on the cross. And that's what he did. I said, that's what he did.
Amen.
He displayed the very love of God for sinners on the cross. And so there's no greater love. No greater love, no greater love, no greater love, no greater love. We were talking last week about how God knows us. He knows even the number of hairs on our head. God really knows us. Mm-hmm. And we're talking about how to get to know your spouse, so on and so forth. Well, you should know your spouse better than you know him, to be honest.
Amen.
But there are some people who do. I'll never forget, we was at a church, and this pastor, I mean, he was all excited. He was sharing all the specs about a jet. He was believing God for a jet. Had pictures and all kind of things. He supposed to be preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, but he had all these specs and these pictures about a jet. He knew all the specs of a jet, but then he was fumbling trying to find scripture. And you know, it's like with some people, they know all the specs about their spouse, but they know no specs about Jesus, the one who saved them, the one who died for them, the one who showed or put on display the greatest love for them. Because, you know, your spouse can't even do you like Jesus.
That's right.
Even though your spouse might have a great display of love for you, but it's not even in comparison to the perfected love that Father God had for you through his son, Christ Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And so that's why, like, some people, they fall. They fall for a love that does not even match the very love of Christ Jesus. And they get disappointed when people don't love them.
Yeah, that's right.
They get disappointed. But y'all not get disappointed when you know that you know that God displayed the greatest love for you through his son Christ Jesus.
Right.
And so you know, hey, what greater love? What other kind of love do you really need? If somebody's not adding to that,
Amen.
If they add to it, you know, thank God for it. But if they not add to it, well, it's not something that you really need.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
You think you do, but you don't.
Right.
You're going crazy. Trying to get somebody to love you.
That's right.
Who don't know really how to love you like Jesus loved you and put on display.
Amen.
And so turn your Bibles once again over to Romans chapter 5, verse 5. In Romans 5, verse 5, the scripture says, And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God, the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which was given unto to us. And so praise God that the Holy Ghost in relation to you is in your heart.
Yes.
Amen.
And your heart has been fixed. Your heart has been made right. Like what David says, Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. Mm-hmm. And so you have to know now that there is a new love in you that was not in you before you got born again. But there's a new love that came in you once you got born again. Once you received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, there was a new love that came in you. And thank God for this new love. It's new love. And when we look at it, there's a whole lot of people in churches don't live by this new love. They really don't. There's some who do, and there's some who don't. Because most times people live by a religious type of love, but they don't live by the love of Christ Jesus. They really don't. But thank God that you have a new love in you now.
Thank you, Jesus.
And it's in your heart. And so your heart been fixed. Your heart been made anew. I say your heart has been made anew. And one of the hardest things, one of the challenges of being men and women of the gospel of Jesus Christ is to get people in church, even preachers, to live by this new love that's on the inside of them. Mm-hmm. That's a challenge. Because the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the flesh don't want to live by this new love. The flesh does not. I mean, not at all. But the Spirit of God, which has been made new by love, wants to put on display the love of the Father, who is where?
Inside of us.
No, the Father is where?
In heaven.
He's in heaven. He's in heaven. And so, like somebody said, we are his hands, we are his feet, we his mouth. Mm-hmm. God looking for people on earth to use. Amen. To love like how he loves from his throne. And so you either are against him or you are with him.
Right.
You are either fighting with him, for him, or you fighting against him. And then, like the scripture teaches us, if God be for you, see, the love of God in you is for you.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah.
I should have really shouted right there.
Amen.
But the love of God in you is for you.
Amen.
And the love of God in you is never against you.
Amen. Glory.
The love of God in you is not your enemy.
Amen. Right.
Amen.
Now, your flesh can be your enemy.
Right.
Your mind, will, and emotions can be an enemy if you don't get your mind, will, and emotions renewed by the Word of God. Mm-hmm. But your recreated spirit, the love of God in you, is not your enemy.
Right.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That love will always love you.
Amen.
Yeah.
If you allow that love to. Because, you know, that love desires to manifest itself in and through you. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen.
Now, we looked at this and we said, okay, I have a new love in me now. I have a new love in me. Most people stay babes all their life. They don't never move from the first phase of just knowing that there's something that happened. I'm born again. And if I was to die tonight, I'd go to heaven. But they don't never move from that phase in their life as far as the next one where, okay, I know that this love is in me. Now, why is this love in me? What am I supposed to do with this love that's in me now? How am I supposed to live in this new love? How is this new love supposed to be perfected through me? Through my body and through my soulish realm. How is this love supposed to be perfected? Through my body and through my soulish realm. So turn your Bibles once again over to 1 John chapter 5. And in 1 John chapter 5, are y'all here today?
Yes.
1 John chapter 5, verse, for time's sake today, we don't want to just do a whole lot, too much repeat. But verse 3, 1 John 5, verse 3, it says, for this is the love of God. Now, where is the love of God in relation to you?
In me. In our hearts.
The love of God is on the inside of you. Now, your greatest fellowship, is fellowshipping with the love of God.
Amen.
That's on the inside of you. That's your greatest fellowship. You ought to seek ye first, when you're talking about the kingdom of God, you ought to seek ye first your fellowship with the love of God.
Amen.
That's what you ought to be seeking ye first. Your fellowship with the love of God. It says in Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
See, God's love in you represents his righteousness.
Hallelujah.
That's what God's love in you represents, his righteousness. And so you're supposed to seek that first. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Mm-hmm. Now, too many people not seeking ye first the love of God.
Mm-hmm.
The love of God.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the Bible says, set your affections on things above,
mm-hmm.
where Christ is. Where Christ is.
Mm-hmm.
And so you are to set your affections on things above where Christ is. Now it's important, like this, Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Now, we like that verse, Matthew 6:33, but we don't know how to live that verse. If we knew how to live that verse, we would have, somebody said, increase daily of things being added unto us.
Right.
You wouldn't have to go around begging.
Glory.
You wouldn't have to go around living in debt your whole life.
Amen.
You wouldn't have to go around just living on barely getting by street all the time. You know, one of the big ones that Brother Tony told us yesterday, one of the biggest problems in majority of all churches is what? What he said?
Giving.
What he said?
Giving.
Now, he didn't say giving. What he said? Tithe. He said tithe, not giving. There's a difference between giving and tithe.
Okay.
And so, well, you already know that, man. Don't act like you don't know that. You know the difference, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Some people give, like when you look at Cain and Abel, both of them gave.
Mm-hmm.
But one of them didn't give what the Lord required. Isn't that right, Brother
Paul? That's right.
And so it's more to it than just giving. It's giving what the Lord says to give.
Yeah.
Amen.
And so one obeyed and the other didn't. And then the one who didn't had killing in his heart towards his brother.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And he was jealous. And so, you know, people who don't give right, they have the spirit of who?
Yeah.
Cain
in them. They really do. Because they ain't about life and life more abundant. They ain't about the love walk.
That's right.
They're not about the love walk. They really not.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it that people kill over crap game? Why do people kill because they want a territory of a corner? Why do they kill? Because
mm-hmm.
it's the love of money. Which is the rule of all evil. Some people are just evil who go to church.
Amen.
Because they don't give. They don't give. You know how I said that?
Yeah.
What is it they don't give?
Tithes.
They don't give tithes.
They don't give tithes. They don't give tithes. But who give them, or who gave them, or who give them tithes to give?
The Lord.
Because the Lord always gives seed
to the sower.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
And so it's according on what you're doing with your
seed.
Yeah. Because if you're doing something that's sinful with your seed, the Bible says, you know, that's the wages of sin is death.
Amen.
You can cause death to come to you because you don't tithe.
Amen.
And people don't understand that. Because, you know, and I'm not even in Malachi, like we said, well, a man robbed God, you need to rob any tithes and offerings. Then you curse with a curse. No, no. We're not saying you curse with a curse, but you can live under a curse.
Yeah.
If you're not doing what the Bible teaches, the purpose in your heart, in order that you don't give out of necessity or you give grudgingly, because I always write on my check now every week, the Lord loves the cheerful giver.
Amen.
That's what he loves. He don't love one who give out of necessity.
Amen.
He doesn't love one who give grudgingly.
Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
But he loving they what?
Cheerful giver.
So when you hear scripture like here in 1 John 5 verse 3, when you hear scripture like this, for this is the love of God that we keep. That we keep is something that you give. Mm-hmm. That we keep, that's something that you obey. Mm-hmm. That we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous.
Right.
The Lord loveth. The Lord loveth a cheerful keeper of his commandments.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
I said the Lord loveth a cheerful keeper of his commandments. And so it says his commandments are not what? Grievous or burdensome.
Amen.
They
Glory.
Really not. And giving tithes is not neither.
Yeah.
I said giving tithes is not neither.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. But you have to understand and know that, you know, your obedience or lack of obedience can affect your greatest harvest.
Mm-hmm.
Some people just want a harvest every now and then. But you ought to have your greatest harvest on your mind.
Yeah.
You understand? We're getting ready for the greatest harvest that we ever had as far as the church,
Hallelujah.
As far as our family,
Yes.
as far as on our jobs,
Yes.
as far as at our schools. We're getting ready to receive. We're receiving because of what we are what?
Sowing,
what we are giving. We ain't talking about money here, neither.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about obedience to the love of God.
Amen.
I said, we're talking about obedience to the love of God. So this is the love of God.
Amen.
So you ought to have this on your mind and your thinking every day. This is the love of God that we do what? We keep his
commandments.
Keep his commandments. Keep his commandments. See, you ought to be looking daily, Lord, what you want me to keep today? You ought to be seeking ye first. Lord, how are you going to reign and rule in my life as far as me keeping your commandments? Because this is the love of God. What's the love of God?
Keeping his commandments.
And his commandments are not
grievous.
You know, anytime you hear somebody say, you know, like you sharing with somebody, you sharing the love of God with them as far as what the word of God says. And then they said, don't judge me. You know what they're really saying? It's not something I have no desire to keep. Y'all hear that?
Mm-hmm.
They really saying, don't judge me because that's something I have no desire to keep that commandment. So I don't want you to judge me in that area.
Mm-hmm.
Because a real man or woman of God wants somebody share some word with them, some truth. Wants somebody share with them the love of God with them.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to check themselves.
Amen. That's true.
And they're not going to come back to you and saying, don't you judge me.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
They're going to be thankful.
Right. Yeah. Amen.
I mean, they're going to really be thankful. It's just like we was here Monday, and it was a sound man from Corner Music. He was here, and he was judging everything. Did he not judge everything?
Everything.
I mean, he judged everything. Now, judging in a good sense. He judged the sound from the keyboard. What do you call this keyboard too, right?
Yep.
He judged the sound from both keyboards. He judged the input, the output.
Mm-hmm.
He judged the sound from the speaker up there by the drums. He judged it.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all hear why I said how I said that? He judged the output, the input. He judged it. And then he judged every microphone. Did he not judge every microphone?
Yes, sir.
He judged every microphone. Every last one of them. Individually. Not at the same time when he first started. But then he got where he started judging all of them at the same time. He judged as far as the software. How the software makes every microphone and every keyboard and every speaker sound. He judged all that. Mm-hmm. He judged it. Then why did he judge it? To help the sound. He even told Brother Mark, he said, when you're singing, you got to kiss the microphone. Brother Mark was standing right up there. I saw him. All that you saying?
Yeah.
Brother Mark was standing right up there. And he was kissing. Brother Mark was up there, y'all. Can y'all picture that? I can picture Brother Danny kissing. Like, Go ahead and kiss him.
All right.
You see that? I saw. I can't imagine Brother Danny kissing Sister Lisa. Kiss. But then Brother Mark was right. He's standing right up there with Paul. What Paul? He was standing right up there. And boy, I tell you, he had. You know why he kissed it? Because the sound man who came here, he told Brother Mark, you got to kiss the microphone when you're singing. You got to kiss the microphone when you're singing. And so they was testing it out. You know what Brother Mark was doing?
Testing it out.
He was judging the microphone.
Right.
Told you I was going to get you in my sermon sometime. So he said, you know, you don't hold a microphone way down here. You don't hold it all up like that. You hold it right there. Because he judged the microphone's right. Different positions. Is it right?
Amen.
And the best sound that he got judging the microphones when Brother Mark was open. I saw Brother Mark standing right up there kissing. When he was standing right up there kissing the microphone. Mm-hmm. Because this sounds like a love affair. Yeah. It was a love affair. But he said, but that's what the young man said. And this young man, he's a teacher. He was a teacher at Nashville State Tech. He does sound all over Middle Tennessee. Amphitheaters, Grand Ole Opry. And so he said, you know, you can set up music. It doesn't matter what kind of music you see. What I have, I always have a job. Did he not say that? He said, I always have a job. Because, you know, because of what he does. And so, you know, I saw Brother Mark kissing the microphone. I mean, because when they was testing my mic out, that's what I was singing. Is that right?
Yep.
Is that what I was saying? Yeah.
Yeah.
And I was hoping and praying that Brother Paul would kiss one, but he never would kiss a microphone. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
All right. And so he said, you can't be afraid to kiss a microphone.
That's right.
Is that what he said?
Yes, sir.
Amen. So praise God. So next Sunday. They love that microphone. And I want everybody here to judge how much they love. And so, you know, it's like this. We ought to be able to judge one another. Mm-hmm. To measure where our love of God is.
That's good.
Amen.
Are we in the babyhood stage? Are we in the, adolescence stage? Mm-hmm. Or are we in the adult stage of the love of God? We ought to be able to judge it. I looked at a photo this morning. Somebody had said, So some of y'all ladies, some of y'all women, y'all got a man in your house who don't want to work, who act like a baby, and they showed a picture of a lady had a grown man. She was changing his diaper, and he had a pacifier in his mouth.
Wow.
My Lord.
And said, some of y'all ladies, y'all need to wake up. As far as y'all just taking care of a man who don't want to really help take care of you, help take care of the household. And so, you know, there's a place that the Lord desires for us to be now as far as his love walk. It's really his love walk. Because the love of God been shed abroad in your heart by or through the Holy Ghost. Come on now. And this is the love of God. What's the love of God? Come on, one more time.
And we keep his commandments.
And his commandments are not what?
Yes.
Now go back one chapter. 1 John 4, verse 21 says, and this commandment have we from him, that he who loveth God loveth his brother also. Mm-hmm. Now that sounds good. What's the first word right there in verse 21?
And.
And last week we didn't start with the previous verse. We just started with that verse, verse 21. But you really need to look at verse 20. If a man said, you know, a whole lot of people in church are saying, they talking. Some people talk too much, but they don't live enough. It says, if a man said, I love God and hateth his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he hath not seen? And so you really, you say you're lying, because really you got double-minded living. I said you have double-minded living. I said, how can you say you love God and hate your
brother?
You know one thing about the nature of God, there is no hatred towards people.
Amen.
God is love.
Amen.
Now what is it that God hate? God hate lying.
Yeah.
God hates lies. Because all liars, they end up where? In a lake of fire. That's where all liars end up. And so God hates lying. He hates lying, but he loves the liar.
Yes.
And that's why you'll have a verse 21 after it, what was said in verse 20. Because how can you say you love God and then you hate if your brother? It says you what? You are a
liar.
For he that loveth not his brother whom he hath seen, how can he love God whom he have not seen?
Mm-hmm.
You know what he's really saying? You don't even really know the love of God.
Right.
Because if you truly knew the love of God, you would love your
brother.
So anybody you hear talking about, they don't love their brother in Christ Jesus, they really don't know love.
Glory.
They really do not know the love of God. And there's a whole lot of church folks being exposed.
Amen.
Amen. That's right. That's good,
man. I mean, being exposed because of black and white issues, because of political issues. And so, you know, they hatred for one another.
Amen.
But if you really love God, you're going to love your brother.
Glory.
And you know, let nothing get in the way of you loving your brother like how Christ loves your brother. Like Christ loves your brother.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
And so too many people go to church, they don't really know the love of God.
Yeah.
Because really knowing the love of God is keeping what he says when all hell break out in America.
Glory.
Because really, knowing the love of God is keeping the love of God when all hell break out in your home.
Yeah.
Glory.
Because really, knowing the love of God is keeping the love of God when all hell break out in your church.
Glory.
You know, some churches are full of what?
Hell.
Brother Mario was telling me Wednesday night that the church in Toronto, they appointed an atheist as their pastor. He just told me that. Because we were talking about how is it How is it that how you can be talked out of your faith in believing who Jesus is and what he did for you? Mm-hmm. How you can be talked out of your soul's salvation? Because when you know that you know and you rooted and grounded, can't nobody talk you out of it.
Glory!
We were talking about in some divinity schools, you have atheists who are professors.
Yeah.
And I told Brother Mario when he told me about that atheist pastor up in Toronto, I said, well, who in their right mind would hire someone who's an atheist at a divinity school? Mm-hmm. Unless they're really trying to trip up. Deceive students.
Yeah.
But if you have to sit and listen for 9 weeks, a semester or a quarter to an atheist, if you're not rooted and grounded in your faith of who Jesus is, you're going to be messed up as hell.
Yeah.
Amen.
When that semester or quarter is over. And that's what happened to people. Mm-hmm. And so I always said, can't nobody talk me out of what I believe. It's too late. Who I believe in, it's just too late. You can't talk me out of believing in Jesus.
Glory. Glory.
Because to be Christ-like is to live the same way when the devil came in the wilderness and tempted Jesus.
Amen.
At his weakest and said, Jesus, I'm going to give you all of this. I'm going to give it to you. It sounded good. But Jesus couldn't be talked out of being the Son of Man nor the Son of God.
That's right.
Through disobedience. He never once disobeyed his daddy. He was tempted in all areas like we are, but yet
without sin.
And so, you know, sometimes you got to tell those atheists, you got to tell those ungodly professors, you got to tell those ungodly church people, ungodly family members, ungodly people on your job, shoot your best shot.
Glory!
Because I'm not going down without a fight. And then if you fight with your faith, you're not going down.
Yeah. Glory!
Hallelujah.
Y'all get that? I said, you're not going down. You're fighting with your faith. Now, if you're trying to fight with something else, you're going down. The devil's going to defeat you. But you know, hey, tell the devil, say, shoot your best shot. You know, God has some love weapons that will always be greater than the weapons of the fiery darts that come from the devil.
That's right. That's right.
So whenever the devil shoots his best shot, I mean, you tell him, the devil, shoot your best shot, but I ain't going down without a fight. I'm always fight the good fight of faith. Because what have we been taught here? Whenever we fight the good fight of faith, we always know we what?
Victory.
We always know we what?
Victory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I always tell people, because I spent 4 years on the campus of American Baptist College, and young guys just ask me, should I go there or not? Should I go there? Should I go to ABC? Should I go to American Baptist College? And I would always tell young preachers, I said, American Baptist College, either make you or break you.
That's right. That's right.
It'll make you or break you. Loving God's way will make you. Mm-hmm. But not loving God's way. Why do you think so many people are having mental collapses now? From the pulpit to the pew. You would think that some people would never have any situation come up in their life because of what kind of education they have, because of what kind of employment that they have, because of where they live, this, that, and the other. You know, we see lawyers, doctors, Indians, and chiefs locked up in jail, in prison. Because your career can't save you.
That's right.
Only Jesus can.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Only Jesus. Amen. So I used to tell young preachers, I said, ABC will make you or break you.
Yeah.
If you don't already have what you need, you're not going to get it here. To be honest. Mm-hmm. And we would see guys, you know, they graduate from ABC, you know, they were top of the class, and they said, well, I need to further my learning of higher education, and I'm going to, you know, the Divinity School here in Nashville. And they think, oh, you know, I'm going to another level than y'all. They will come back screwed up. Mm-hmm. I mean, they will come back screwed up.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we would be like, watch so-and-so, watch how they come back. And then they come try to preach to us that foolishness. Mm-hmm. And you know, we wouldn't fall in for none of that stuff. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why like some people don't like talking to me now, because I don't listen to all that foolishness.
Yeah.
My ears was not made for foolishness.
Amen.
My ears was made for truth.
Amen.
The Lord God says, he that have an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Amen. I don't see where it says be listening to what everything else is saying.
Glory.
It says listen to what the Spirit of God is saying to the church. Not what all these religions and different people who's filled with unbelief and doubt and atheist spirits, what they saying. No, no, Jesus taught. My sheep, they hear my voice.
Amen. Right.
Glory.
Yes. And so that's the voice I'm listening to. That's the voice my ears are attentive to. Mm-hmm. His words, his voice, the Spirit of the living Christ. Yeah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And so too many people getting spooked. Amen. I said too many people getting spooked.
That's right.
Too many people being deceived. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, you ought to be so thankful that you build, and listen to me now, look at me, you building your house on a solid foundation.
Yeah.
Now, what's the solid foundation that you're building your house on? Coming to Jesus.
Yes.
Wait a minute. Coming to Jesus.
Yeah.
You seeking ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. So that means you're doing what every day? You're coming to Jesus every day. You know, you're not caught up in that, what we used to sing years ago. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Right now. Come to Jesus. Come to Jesus. Right now. He will save you. He will save you. He will save you. Right now. Oh, he will save you. Now, you may kiss the microphone. We thought that was only an invitation to
come
to Jesus.
Yeah.
But you need to continue to come to him in fellowship.
Yeah.
Amen.
Every day.
And so, I mean, you married folks know when you've been with your spouse. You know then. You know it. I mean, y'all know when you've been with Jesus.
Yes.
Glory.
Glory to God.
Glory.